like to introduce our speaker today. His name is Gary Kessler. He is a former president of the Westboro Community Land Trust, and he is very active in the Massachusetts Butterfly Club. And right now he is spearheading an effort jointly put on by the Massachusetts Butterfly Club and the Mass Audubon Society to reintroduce Baltimore checker spot butterflies to the Broad Meadow Brook Wildlife Sanctuary, which is the Mass Audubon property in Worcester. And he's been taking butterfly photographs for many, many years. It's a passion of his. He's traveled to do it, and he also takes many right here in Massachusetts. So I know you're going to enjoy his work, and without further ado, I'd like to introduce Gary Kessler.
All right, so the first thing is, I don't speak very loudly. Can everybody hear me? If you can't hear me, let me know. I'm going to speak for a while about a number of disparate topics having to do with butterflies. I'll try to connect them. So take a good look at these, because the pictures you're about to see aren't going to be as big as these typically. I'm going to show you lots of different stuff. I'm not necessarily going to talk about all of it, so if you see something and you have a question, let me know at the time, and I'll point to the thing and say, gee, I don't know the answer to that, and we'll move on. So this was up here. One of the things that I did a few years ago was, in taking pictures of butterflies, I wind up with lots of pictures, and sometimes I don't know what to do with them. And one day I decided I would play with one of those pictures, and I cut a little piece of a photograph of a butterfly wing out in the rectangle. And I sort of cut and pasted and replicated it and rotated it, and you get some interesting patterns. That's actually made from a photograph of a Juniper Hare Street butterfly. I'll see if I can speak up a little bit better. Everybody hear me now?
Yep.
Okay. So I started taking pictures about 35 years ago, when we had our first child, actually, and acquired a camera. And I know for some of the people around here, they won't remember there was this thing called film. So I started on film. And with film, you can take a lot of pictures of nature pictures and wind up throwing all of them away. So to avoid that problem, I start by taking pictures of wildflowers. And so wildflowers were something I was particularly interested in even as a kid. And that's how I started out. Wildflowers are relatively simple. You don't need lots of fancy stuff, a decent camera, a close-up lens, not too much wind, and you can take decent pictures of wildflowers. Nice thing about them is they don't run away. From that, I moved on to butterflies. I started taking pictures of butterflies about the time that digital cameras came out. And the issue is, they do run away. But the nice thing about them, come on in, folks. So, as I was saying, I moved on to butterflies. Of course, everybody likes birds. Birds are very uncooperative. A close-up lens doesn't work very well on birds. So at some point, I got myself a nice telephoto lens. I started taking pictures of birds. But the reality is, I really don't care. I'm curious about anything I can find, and I'll try to learn about it and take pictures of it. So.
All these pictures are yours.
Yes.
You've really seen all these things.
Yes. And most of them you can see right here, fairly locally, around Massachusetts. And stuff. So, one of the things that, come on in, folks. Somebody want to grab some chairs. Somebody who talks about butterflies always gets asked, how do you tell the difference between a butterfly and a moth? Right? Does anybody know how to tell the difference between a butterfly and a moth?
No.
Oh, you win a prize! I wish I had one.
Could you repeat
that? That's right. So one of the simplest ways that you can tell is by looking at the antenna. Butterflies have club-like antenna. Moths, on the other hand, have filament-like antenna, like this here, or feathery antenna, like this gypsy moth here, right? So here's the question. How many pictures of butterflies do you see on that slide? Come on.
One.
How many pictures of butterflies are on the slide?
One.
We got one.
Three.
We got three.
Three.
We got two.
None.
Those are all butterflies. Everything else on that slide is a moth. Okay?
How many butterflies? One.
There are three pictures of butterflies. The ones that have the white boxes around them are all butterflies. This is a butterfly. These guys are butterflies. Your little club-like antenna. It's a butterfly. Everything else there is a moth. So, there'll be a quiz at the end. Not really.
Okay.
We need to. All right, so I'm going to give you a little bit of butterfly 101. And we're going to do kind of a survey of butterflies to orient you to butterflies. And then we'll start talking a little bit about different things that butterflies do in the environment. Butterflies, you know, can be broken down into some fairly large groups. This is kind of a smattering of groups. There are lots of species worldwide. In Massachusetts, there's generally about over 100 species that you can find in a season. Butterflies here in Massachusetts. Next, Tim. So one of those groups is called gossamer wings, and I've broken gossamer wings down into its subgroups because they're kind of interesting. About a third of the butterflies worldwide are gossamer wings. One of those groups is these elfins. Among the smallest butterflies in Massachusetts is this guy down here, the bog elfin. These guys tend to come out earlier in the season, spring, early summer kind of thing. And as you can tell, they're generally kind of brown. And a lot of them, they live in kind of funny places for butterflies, like the woods or swamps or places you don't normally think of to go look for butterflies. So you may be taking a hike in the woods sometime and see some little brown thing flying along the path and go, that's a moth. Well, actually, it might be one of these, a butterfly. One of the interesting things about elfins is they're kind of hairy, right? And you can kind of see this guy's pretty hairy. They even have hairy eyeballs. I'd like to be able to tell you why they have hairy eyeballs, but nobody really knows. So when you grow up, if you study butterflies, you can tell me why they have hairy eyeballs. Figure that out for me. Another group, which is a little bit larger group, still in the gossamer wings, are the hair streaks. I'm particularly fond of the hair streaks because they have some interesting behaviors, and we'll talk about those a little bit more in a bit. Okay. Then we begin to get into a little bit of color with the blues and coppers, which kind of rounds out the gossamer wings. And we have this guy up here, which is the harvester, which is a group that has only a handful of species worldwide. We happen to have one of those species here in Massachusetts, and again, it has some interesting behaviors that we'll talk about in a little bit.
What exactly does gossamer
mean? Gossamer is in filmy. The brushfoot is about two-thirds of the butterflies worldwide. This is a huge group, and it's so big that I really can't break it down into the subgroups for you. There are just too many. But to name a few, you know, we've got things like admirals and viceroys and ladies, the monarch that everybody knows. There are fritillaries, crescents, buckeyes, commas, you know, and the list just goes on and on and on. So brushfoots are named brushfoots because they have a brush foot. So we've got a couple of smart people down here in the front, instead of all the video people in the back there, sorry. How many legs do insects have?
Six.
Six?
Yeah.
I like that.
Yes.
How many legs do you see?
Three.
Yeah, so the fourth one is hiding back here. You can't see it. Is that an insect? Are butterflies insects? Butterflies are insects. Where are the six legs? Go ahead, Tim. So there's the sixth leg. For some reason, brushfoot butterflies keep their four legs folded up against their body behind their head. And this is the leg, and right here is the brush foot. Because of all the hairs, it looks like a brush. So that's where they get their name, brushfoots. Swallowtails, most of you have probably seen one of these flying around in the summertime. They have these nice tails. It's actually a very small group of butterflies. Only about 3% of the butterflies in the world are swallowtails, but we happen to have several species of swallowtails here in Massachusetts, so we think of them as being more common, and they actually are worldwide. The largest butterfly that flies in Massachusetts since 2011, it's a relatively newcomer, is this guy here, the giant swallowtail. It has a 6-inch wingspan. As it compared to our smallest butterfly, that little bog elephant, which fits on a dime. So quite a range in size. The whites and the sulfurs, ubiquitous in the summertime. They fly all summer long. You find them pretty much in any field and stuff. Again, a relatively small group, about 6% of the butterflies worldwide fall into this group. But again, because we see them so commonly, we don't realize that they're kind of a special group in that regard. And here we have a group that most people don't even think of butterflies at all, called the skippers. We won't talk about them a great deal, but there are about 3,500 species worldwide. We have dozens of these species here in Massachusetts. A lot of them live in grassy fields. Some of them live in other kinds of habitats. So we have grass skippers, we have spreadwing skippers, we have, things like cloudy wing skippers, long-tail skippers, which is not actually native to Massachusetts. Every once in a while we get a stray that comes up this far north, but it's really a southern butterfly. So, skippers.
What does skipper refer to, how they go from flower
to
flower, or how they move, or?
Yeah, you can think of these as the jet planes. So when they take off, they can fly, some of them, like these little guys, they fly so fast, it's actually hard to follow them. Mm-hmm. And yeah, they seem to skip from flower to flower. So I wasn't really going to mention them, but I'm going to mention them. There is another group of butterflies, and this kind of rounds out all the groups of butterflies for you. They're called metal barks. There are no metal barks in Massachusetts, and we're going to focus mostly on Massachusetts butterflies. This is really a southern group. The northernmost of these, the northern metal bark, its range extends up into Connecticut, and that's it. So we're too far north for these guys. So now I'm going to start talking a little bit more about butterflies in the environment, and how they get by and how they interact. These three butterflies are also not found in Massachusetts, but they are found here in New England, and they represent examples of something called remnant populations. These are small, isolated populations cut off by hundreds, several hundred miles typically, from the real population in the country. So these top two guys, the purplish fritillary and the Arctic here, are high altitude specialists. They only occur above 4,500 feet, 5,000 feet. Well, how many places in New England do you know of that are above 4,500 feet. All right, not in Massachusetts, right? You need to go to the top of the White Mountains. And in fact, most of the White Mountains really don't make it that high. They make it about there, but not quite that high. So you've got Mount Washington, Mount Katahdin. Those stick up far enough. What happened was in the last ice age, the ice came and it covered everything, but you had these little places that stuck up, and the butterflies survived the ice age on the top of the mountains and became isolated and have managed to survive there ever since, where the rest of the population is off somewhere where the ice sheet didn't cover the ground, which is nowhere near here. This guy is a remnant. That's a clay, it's copper, found in wetlands. And it became isolated because the flower that it's sitting on is actually a rare wetlands plant called shrubby cinquefoil. And as that plant became rare because its habitat declined, because we don't like wetlands, we tend to do things to make them go away, the butterfly also became rare. And so the environment for it became very fragmented and isolated, and so did the butterfly. Cut off from the Dorcas copper population to the west, which is really, it's a subspecies of that, and it's sort of evolving separately now. Good. So, butterflies are prey. Birds like to eat them. Other insects like to eat them. And you may have noticed that when they fly around, they kind of stand out a lot, too. So, generally not a good thing for prey. So they get by having interesting colors and patterns, often that look like something else in the environment. And we're going to talk about different schemes that they use to basically hide in plain sight. One of those schemes, which is technically called Bayesian mimicry, is looking like something that's undesirable or harmful. This guy here, the European hornet moth, it's a moth. You know, when I run across one of these in the field, I give it a wide berth. It just doesn't look like something you want to mess with. So you stay away from it. And it's a very effective scheme. Another form of Bayesian mimicry involves the use of eye spots. So we have eye spots, eye spots. Go on to the next one, Tim. This is a Milbert's tortoiseshell, and it actually has eye spots right here. This is a cat's face, and it's a very interesting rendition of a cat's face. We've got the nose, we've got the mouth, we've got whiskers, and over here we even have the markings of a wild cat, a serval, or that kind of thing, on the earmarks and stuff. It's really quite impressive. The outside of this butterfly looks like tree bark, and the butterfly is a woodland butterfly. It likes to sit on limbs and trunks of trees with its wings closed. So you can imagine if you're a little bird and you come up behind this thing and it flashes in your face like that, you might take off.
Is it in Massachusetts?
Yes. Most of these butterflies are found in Massachusetts. In fact, the buckeye has things that we typically call owl's eyes. Uses the same kind of flashing technique to ward off primarily birds. Little birds don't like owls very much. Owls eat little birds. I happen to think of this as more of an array like a spider, a really big spider with lots of eyes. And this guy down here, which you've seen head on, has two of these eye spots on either side. This is actually a snake mimic. Another thing that birds don't really like a great deal. Lots of swallowtails, this is a swallowtail caterpillar, have eye spots like that and are snake mimics at various stages in their life cycle. Now, we were often taught, this is a viceroy up here, this is a monarch, that viceroys mimicked monarchs because monarchs have bad stuff in them and they're unappealing and toxic. So birds will stay away from them. And that would be Batesian mimicry on the part of the viceroy, looking like something bad when you're not really bad, right? Well, it turns out we weren't taught right. The viceroy also eats plants as a caterpillar and accumulates toxic chemicals in its body. So what we have here are two things that are bad to eat that look the same. That's not Batesian mimicry. That's Eulerian mimicry. And what's going on here is that they have this very flashy pattern. You know, an orange is a warning pattern, right? And because this pattern is found that much more commonly in nature, because both species exhibit the pattern, the birds learn that much faster to avoid them all. So both species benefit by the look-alike that way. So this is kind of a cooperative thing, as opposed to the Batesian mimicry, which was really kind of a threatening kind of thing. Here we have a really bizarre mimic. This is our little harvester butterfly again. And its caterpillars, seen here, there is one caterpillar, here's another caterpillar, are mimicking a colony of woolly aphids on a tree branch. These little aphids basically suck tree sap and, you know, live in great congregations on the branch of a tree. And these guys are hiding in plain sight right in that colony. So you have a caterpillar mimicking a colony of some other animal. Very peculiar. Of course, everybody's familiar with crypsis, basically looking like your background, tree bark, lichens and rocks, dead leaves. Another form of crypsis is looking like bird droppings. Lots of caterpillars like to look like bird droppings. You know, bird droppings aren't very good food. So it's fairly effective. You know, these guys are all looking like bird droppings. This is a black swallowtail caterpillar in a very early stage after it's just hatched out of its egg. This is that same caterpillar in a much later stage, no longer looking like a bird dropping. So what gives there? I don't really know the answer, but I do know that in this stage they have other defense mechanisms that they can employ. So maybe they no longer feel that they need this camouflage. I don't know. The most bizarre kind of mimicry is looking like yourself. How can that possibly be helpful? Well, that's what this is. Lots of hair streaks employ this technique. This is a gray hair streak up here. And this is basically a sequence of photos to show you that what it does is it waggles its hind wings like this, back and forth. And these tails here, we'll use this one, they look like antenna. And these spots here are head spots. And so when a bird comes up behind this thing doing this, with its tails looking like antenna feeling around for stuff, the bird will strike back here at the head. You see this little notch here? See this? That's where a bird took a bite out of the hind wing where it thought the head of the cat, the butterfly was. And the butterfly gets away. That's how auto mimicry works. That's how looking like yourself actually works. Really strange. This is a similar example, but I couldn't call it auto mimicry because I really don't know that this caterpillar is what this butterfly is supposed to look like. But you see the caterpillar here? Here's the head of the caterpillar. Here are the feet of the caterpillar. It's amazing, some of the patterns that are on these things. And then there's just no explanation for things like this. I'm so flashy, you're going to leave me alone? So I'm going to digress a little bit and give you an idea of what it's like to go hunting for a rare butterfly and tell you a little bit about some of the behavior that I saw in this butterfly as well. This is a Hessel's hair streak. And Hessel's Hair Streaks, their host plant, the food for the caterpillar, are Atlantic white cedars. We have Hessel's Hair Streaks probably here in town, although one hasn't been seen for a long time, and they are would be in Cedar Swamp. The cedars in Cedar Swamp are Atlantic white cedars, right? Atlantic white cedars are pretty big trees, you know, 40, 50, 60 feet when they're mature. And they live in swamps, right? So it ain't that easy to get around and look for these things in the tops of trees. Well, at this point, I had taken pictures of lots of hair streaks. I mentioned I like hair streaks. And I really wanted to get a decent picture of this butterfly. And so down in the Great Blue Hills, there's a boardwalk through a, it's actually a bog, not a swamp, to be technical. A boardwalk there that you can walk through a cedar swamp that has a colony of these butterflies. And I went down there year after year trying to get a picture of these. And this was the best I could do, right? So I wasn't real thrilled about that. So one year Annie and I decided we were going to go out for spring migration of birds out to the shores of Lake Erie in Ohio. But on the way, because this butterfly comes out at the same time as spring migration, we were going to stop at a place in New Jersey that has Atlantic white cedars that grow in sand plains. So you can also get bogs in sand plains. They're not all sphagnum bogs, you know, which are wet and goopy and stuff. But once in sand plains, you can walk on because it's sand, right? So we go down to New Jersey and we look for this butterfly over the weekend on our way out to Ohio. And as the slide says, we found everything but the butterfly, right? Butterfly was supposed to be out, it was the right time of year, supposed to be lots of them. There were lots of nice little flowers for the butterflies to be on. Couldn't find the butterfly. So that was kind of frustrating. So we moved on, we went out to Ohio, and we looked at colorful little birds that were migrating. Some of these birds will migrate thousands of miles from South America up into Canada, and then back again each year and stuff. And you can imagine that if you're migrating like that, that when you get to the edge of the Great Lakes, you might be a little tired and hungry. And so you might land before you have to cross the water and stuff. So they tend to drop out in this particular marsh there on the edge of the lake, and you get these great concentrations of these birds. They're literally dripping off the trees, and they are so hungry and so tired that you can sort of walk right up to them in the scrub, which isn't much higher than you, and you can be this far away from these little birds and stuff. So it's a great experience if you want to look for little birds in the spring. It is a day's drive, however. So at the end of that week that we had planned to spend out there, not having found my hair streak, back in New Jersey, we decided we were going to drive back to New Jersey. And so we got up in the morning and we drove all the way through back to the spot, you know, where those butterflies are in New Jersey. And we got there and it was about 5 o'clock, a little bit before. So it's kind of late in the day. But this particular butterfly does have a habit of maybe coming down to some flowers late in the day and stuff. So as we stop at this place, I see somebody else coming out of the site. And they look like they've been looking for the butterflies, because why else would you be there? And so I said, hey, did you see anything? And the answer was no. You know, after you've just driven for 8+ hours and several hundred miles, you don't want to hear no, right? So I said, well, we just got here, we drove a long ways, I think I'll go take a look anyway. And we walk on in, right? And he goes, well, you know, I'll come with you for a few more minutes, an extra set of eyes, you never know. And we walk in a little ways, and I'm kind of looking around, and he's looking around, and I look up, and I see him looking at something at the ground. And I start coming over, he looks up to call me over, right? And I get over, we look back at the ground, and there's nothing there. But he had seen one of those butterflies at 5 o'clock, right? So he was real happy that he went back with me. because this was a guy who was doing something called a butterfly big year. He was traveling around the country seeing how many species of butterflies he could see in 1 year. He was from California and come all the way to New Jersey to find that butterfly. So he was real happy. He got the butterfly. I still haven't seen it. Right? Well, we had really just stopped there that evening just to take a quick look, but we were planning to spend the night and come back the next day and look for the butterfly again. So that's what we did. When we came back the next day, we got up early, right? And we looked for the butterfly. There's no butterfly. We hang out there all day long, you know, through the morning. We eat lunch. There's no butterfly. You know, there are these brown tree lizards. You know, after a while, you get a little tired of them. Lots of tiger beetles. Tiger beetles are interesting. They run real fast on the ground, and they eat other insects and stuff. There's lots of different kinds. But mostly, I paid a lot of attention to these guys, which are Lone Star ticks, which, sadly, are coming our way. I don't actually know if they're here yet, but this is a third kind of tick, which carries some very nasty diseases. And the ground was crawling with them. So as we spent the day there, you're constantly doing this, making sure that the ticks stay away from you and they're not coming towards you and stuff. We're there through the afternoon, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock. There are no butterflies, leave alone the hair streak I'm looking for. There's just, it's so boring. I can't tell you. And it gets to be about 4 o'clock, nothing going on. I'm determined we're going to stay there until at least 5 o'clock because I know that thing has been seen at 5 o'clock, right? But it's getting really tough to sit around in the ticks waiting for this thing to show up if it does. So 10 of 5, no butterfly. 5 of 5, no butterfly. The sun is getting down. The shadows are long underneath the trees. We're all in shade. It is not a great time anymore for looking for taking pictures of butterflies and stuff. 5 o'clock comes, and Annie says, "What's that?" And out of this little tree that we've been sitting next to all day long comes this little dark triangle down, and it lands on a flower. And I carefully, but quickly, scurry on over, aim the camera, get focused, and it flies away. It lands on another flower. I kind of move around, get lined up again. I can't get a shot. It's in the brush and obscure and stuff. Oh, flies again. And it goes into the shadows under a tree and lands in the open on some flowers. And I go around again, looking to get a picture of this butterfly. And finally get one. So, what happened the night before? I now got to see the behavior of this butterfly. So it was on that flower for a few seconds, right? I didn't get a lot of chances, so I was lucky to get this. And then what it did is it climbed down into the ground cover. This is called sand myrtle. Sand myrtle is only about yay high, and it's very thick. It's a ground cover. And it climbed down into that stuff, and it hid below the flowers and stuff. If I hadn't seen it do that, I could have never found it again. And it stayed there. It didn't come back out. In fact, I tried to get it to come back out, and it just went farther in. I think it came down, and it was going to stay there for the night because it's close to the ground, and it's a little bit warmer than up in the trees. I don't really know. But, you know, it's an interesting behavior, again, that we saw. So a few more things about butterfly behaviors that you might not be aware of. Next one, Tim. So here we have a butterfly on this nice, long, tubular red flower. Nice, long, tubular red flowers are hummingbird attractors. This flower is for hummingbirds. It is this shape to keep bees out, right? Hummingbirds have nice, long tongues and can reach the nectar back here. What happens is these things have very sweet nectar, because hummingbirds need lots of fuel to keep going, right? Really pisses the bees off. So what the bees do is they come along and they chew a little hole in the flower, right here. so they can steal the nectar and get at it. And that's what the butterflies come along afterwards behind the bees, and they can nectar on these flowers. So nectar stealing, nice way to get a sweet snack. This oak hair streak here is a rare butterfly in Massachusetts. Its host plant are fully mature oak trees, 40, 50 foot oak trees, right? Occasionally, like this one, it will come down to nectar on a flower. This is an Edwards hair streak. Its host plant is scrub oak, which short kind of thing. Also oak trees. It's actually nectaring on what appears to be an acorn here. But that's not an acorn. That's right here is a gall on that acorn. Does everyone know what a gall is? You know what a gall is? That's where some insect, or sometimes a fungus, will infect this. In this case, a wasp has laid its egg in the bud of this acorn. And the wasp larva emits chemicals that take over the biology of the plant, of the acorn, and cause the acorn to form this protective coating around it, which is called the gall. But in addition, in this particular case, it causes that gall to exude a sweet honeydew with sugar in it. And that sugar attracts ants and wasps, which then protect this from what might be predators of the wasp larva. And the butterflies nectar on that sugar. So these guys who live up in 50-foot oak trees don't necessarily have to come down to the ground to nectar. And so we're not really sure how common they are, because if you noticed, there aren't a lot of people out there looking for butterflies and cherry pickers in oak forests. So this butterfly is still listed and protected in the state, but we actually don't know if it's really rare or not. And then we have the harvester. And the harvester caterpillars live in woolly aphid colonies. Woolly aphids, as I said, they suck tree sap, and they exude honeydew out of their back ends. And the ants come along, and the wasps, you can see a little droplet of honeydew being harvested here by the ant, right? And they protect these colonies. Well, these caterpillars eat woolly aphids. So the harvester comes along, it lays its egg in the colony, the egg hatches out, and these caterpillars consume the colony of aphids. The ants and the wasps don't recognize these as threats, and they protect the caterpillars along with the colony. So that's how that wasp mania mimicry is so successful, because not only do they look like something that they're not, but they're protected by other species as well. I keep predators away from them. Very effective technique. So a couple of other things that are going on in our environment is, one thing about things is it's always changing, right? There are ecological changes going on. Everybody's heard of this thing called climate change. And we can see different responses to this in the butterfly populations in Massachusetts. Ecologically, one of the activities that's going on is called host switching. So the caterpillars eat specific kinds of plants. So the caterpillars are tied to specific plants. And those plants are called the hosts for the caterpillars. And a lot of native caterpillars, butterflies, their hosts were native plants of various kinds. But what we're finding is that over time, these plants are under ecological pressure. Some of them, maybe you're eating them, and so they're becoming scarcer. Some of them, there are other changes going on in the environment, they're becoming scarcer. And we're finding that while some of the butterfly populations may be declining because of this, other populations are adopting alternate host plants, or they're switching their host plant from their traditional host plant to something new. in a lot of cases, the host plants that they're adopting that are new are non-native species. And while you can see that there are a lot of butterflies here that are doing this, this is a more complete list, in fact. There are dozens and dozens of butterflies that are being affected by these changes here in Massachusetts now. In terms of climate, if you think that things are maybe getting a little bit warmer, a lot of butterflies live in something called the Southern Range. Others live in something called the Northern Range. Massachusetts is in this overlap zone called the transition zone. So we're kind of uniquely situated to see changes that are going on due to climate change in the populations. Yes. Here we have examples of butterflies that are undergoing changes due to climate change. The Butterfly Club had amassed data over 20, 30 years having to do with sightings of butterflies that involved where they were seen, when they were seen, and how many were seen. So you can imagine if you've got a few decades of this data, some smart Harvard graduate student, as it was, might come along and say, gee, I'd like to do an analysis of that and see if there are any trends. And there were lots of things to be learned from the data. We have these kinds of butterflies up here that are northern butterflies. And over the past couple of decades, their populations in Massachusetts have declined by 4/5. So we have about, you know, 1 out of 5 of those that we used to have, say 20 years ago. They used to be a lot more common. We have southern butterflies that have come up from the south, that southern range, into our area that didn't used to appear here, but we now see regularly during the summer. But they're not able to overwinter our harsh winters. And so every year they have to come up again and stuff. But that's another indication that they're now able to survive here and get up here in the summertime, whereas when we were living in colder times, they weren't as close and couldn't get here. The giant swallowtail, as I mentioned, first appeared in Massachusetts in 2011, not that long ago. This is a southern species. It first appeared, in fact, in the southwestern part of the state. And over that first year or so, or actually the second year, it is a very strong flyer, and it had spread all the way across the state from west to east and up into southern New England. And it's now all the way up in 2016 into central New England. So this butterfly has invaded our range and has successfully overwintered and breeds in Massachusetts, and only in the last 5 years has that been the case. Another example of a butterfly that's come up from the south is the red-banded hairstreak, but it uses a different path. It comes up along the coast, right? Coast tends to be a little bit milder, so it's easier. And then it also moves up river valleys, again, which are lowlands, and so they tend to be a little bit milder. And it, again, has successfully overwintered for several years and is now a native species in Massachusetts where it didn't used to be. Little Yellow, on the other hand, uses the same migration path, but it's not as winter hardy. And it didn't successfully overwinter when we had that hard winter a couple of years ago. And so it would have to come back, but we haven't seen it return again. So examples of butterflies that are adjusting their ranges north and south due to the effects of climate change. You can see there's a long list of butterflies. These are butterflies that are leaving our area going north, butterflies that are entering our area going from the south. I haven't bothered to add them up, but it's probably more than half of the butterflies you find here in Massachusetts. We're seeing range shifts going on because of climate change. One of the things that hasn't kept up with all of these changes in the environment is the conservation status. So in Massachusetts, we actually protect some species that are rare in our environment. There are actually 8 butterflies that are on the protected list that are shown here. A couple of them, it's not clear whether or not, in fact, they should be protected because they're becoming more populous. Like this guy here is not that uncommon anymore. We talked a little bit about this guy and whether or not he's really as uncommon as we thought. Next one. But there are tons of butterflies that, in fact, are being affected in ways that they're becoming scarce and rare. These guys are all rare butterflies, hard to find, have been declining in our area, and they have no conservation status whatsoever. A more complete list of these. I would note that while many of these are becoming rare in Massachusetts, that doesn't necessarily mean they're becoming rare worldwide. A lot of them are much easier to find if you go farther north. So that brings us to our project. I think it was mentioned that we started a project over at Broadmeadow Brook Audubon Sanctuary in Worcester, involving the Baltimore checker spot. Baltimore checker spot is a butterfly that is being affected by climate change. It's becoming rarer in the southern part of its range. It's also a butterfly that is adopting an alternate host plant. So it fits what we've been talking about. So why did I pick Baltimore checker spots? Well, Baltimore checker spots were found at the Audubon Sanctuary 10 years ago and before. But something happened to them and they disappeared. So I wanted to sort of reintroduce them there. Well, we don't really know what happened to them. It is likely that they were preyed upon by wasps. The last year that I saw them, I did actually see wasps taking checker spot caterpillars. So the wasps may have wiped out the colony. I don't really know. Here we have a different wasp and a different caterpillar, but this wasp is preying upon the caterpillar. It has gone off and it's captured the caterpillar and stung it and paralyzed it. Caterpillar's still alive. It's going to bury this caterpillar alive and lay an egg on it. The egg is going to hatch out and it's going to consume the caterpillar from the inside out, kind of like aliens in the movie. And then it's going, when it matures, it's going to pop out of the caterpillar as a fully mature wasp and fly off and do it all over again. Nature is just lovely. Baltimore checker spot range looks like this. You can see we have lots of checker spots in our area. They're not really in danger at all. We don't need any special permits or anything like that. But down here around Washington, Baltimore, there are papers you can find in the journals indicating that the butterfly is becoming rare. And so you can sort of see the southern edge of the range and it's going this way. So a little bit about the habitat. I mentioned that it uses multiple hosts. The native host plant is white turtlehead, which is a wildflower, a very nice wildflower. The deer love this plant and they just come along and they just take all the tops off of them. And if there happen to be, you know, butterfly eggs on the underside of the leaf, well, they get a little extra protein in their meal too. So this plant is actually becoming rare. And one of the reasons for that actually is deer browse in the environment. The butterfly is adopting this common lawn weed. And this is the host plant that we're going to use. So the larva need one of these two plants when they're young, when they first hatch out, because there are chemicals in the plants that help the larva grow and also protect the larva from predation by making it unpalatable to birds, primarily. This plant here grows in wet meadows, which isn't a very nice place to walk through looking for butterflies. But this plant grows in lawns, which are easy to walk through looking for butterflies. And since we want this butterfly to be near the visitor center, which is an area with lawn, we're going to use this as our host plant and not worry about the deer eating our plants because the deer don't eat this. So we've got a nice group of volunteers together. And this person right here is our very own Elaine Moore. Thank you, Elaine, sitting in the back, trying to be inconspicuous. And we spent a day basically going out to some fields in Westboro, digging up these weeds that nobody really wants in their fields anyway, and transplanting them over to the Audubon Sanctuary, and making basically a new habitat for the butterflies. All these little blue flags are where we had plants so that we can find them again. So probably this year we have enough plants that we can begin to think about introducing our butterfly. And so the butterfly life cycle, it starts out with a couple of butterflies, adults that mate, and the female goes and lays eggs on the underside of the host plant's leaves. And those eggs start out yellow, and they change over time to red. They take about 20 days to mature, and then we get caterpillars. The caterpillars hatch out, and they eat all the host plants they can find. They're eating machines. And for the first four stages of the caterpillar, which are called instars, an instar is the time in between. So caterpillars are insects. Insects have exoskeletons, hard skins on the outside, sort of, which means they can only grow so big before they fill up their exoskeleton, and then they need to shed that skin. And every time they shed the skin, you get a new stage or instar. And the butterfly will go through about four of those, caterpillar will go through about four of those in the first season. And then, which is fairly unusual for a butterfly caterpillar, it overwinters as a caterpillar. So it rolls up a leaf near the ground, and it basically is there on the ground in its leaf for the winter time. And in the spring, everything thaws out, caterpillar comes back. And interestingly enough, in the second year caterpillar, post-hibernation caterpillars, they'll take other plants besides their specific host plants, but they really prefer the host plant. But this guy here is on a plant called Rattlebox, which is not a primary host plant. And that's a second year caterpillar. And if we're really successful next year, we'll get these around the end of May, beginning of June. Butterfly, or the caterpillar rather, pupates and forms a chrysalis. Butterflies form chrysalises. Moths have cocoons and other things and stuff, another distinction. But Baltimore checker spot chrysalises are, you don't see them a lot. You see monarch ones, but they're also very pretty. And again, after about 3 weeks, towards the end of June, beginning of July, those things hatch out, we get adults, the life cycle starts over, and hopefully you'll be able to see this at Broad Meadow Brook in a couple of years. So a couple of resources that are online that people might find useful. The Butterfly Club's website, you can just Google Massachusetts Butterfly Club and find it, is actually an excellent resource for being able to see and identify butterflies of Massachusetts. So, you know, if you see something outside and you think it's a butterfly and you don't know what it is, you can go here and you can browse on down through the thumbnail pictures and you can probably find it relatively quickly. And all the species that you would find in Massachusetts, you can find here. Butterflies of Massachusetts is another related website where for people that really want to find in-depth information about a specific butterfly, they can go here. And there are sort of academic papers for many of the Massachusetts butterflies that describe things about their life cycle, things about the history of them over time in state, where they might be found, things like that. North American Butterfly Association, NABA, is the butterfly association for butterflies in North America. And they too have some very good resources at their website. And Butterflies of Moths in North America, I believe, is a university sponsored site, but it is sort of the premier site for finding information and photos and identifying butterflies and moths all through North America. We talked about these kinds of mosaic patterns up top. This is what you can make from the wings of a Baltimore checker spot. Oh, and I do maintain a photography site on that. So, any questions?
Well, question about monarch butterflies. I used to catch them for a classroom 20 years ago, and now I haven't seen any.
Yes, well, you haven't seen any because the population crashed about 2 or 3 years ago. And it would not be a good thing to be catching them for classrooms anymore. We advise people, in fact, we generally say use the American lady or the painted lady. Those are not in crisis. Monarch is very slowly coming back, so, and stuff, but we recommend for that kind of thing a different caterpillar be used.
Why did it happen?
There are differences of opinion about that, but most of those opinions fairly strongly point to causes that are man-made. Mm-hmm. And there might be multiple reasons at that point. Anything else? Thank you very much.